All right. So now I'd like to introduce Billy Gregory. Billy Gregory is an accessibility engineer with the Paciello Group. Bill is based out of Toronto, Canada. Billy's an active participant in the Toronto accessibility community, serving as a co-organizer of the Toronto Accessibility and Inclusive Design Monthly Meetup, as well as the Accessibility Camp Toronto. Further ado, I will leave it to Bill.
Hey, thanks, Carl. Can everybody hear me okay? We're good? I'm just going to assume that's a yes. So welcome, everybody, and thank you very, very much for joining not only my talk, but all of the talks today. This is a pretty awesome, awesome event, and it's really great that I am. Pretty honored that I am a part of it. I wanted to do something a little bit different from the other talks. We've had a lot of amazing, amazing talks today so far. We've got plenty more to go, and they've all been amazingly technical, which is great. I wanted to do something that might sort of bring in some people that are new to the game and might not understand some of what we're talking about. But I think it's important for these folks that are new to accessibility to understand that they are not alone. We've all been there. We were all new to accessibility, and we all had to start somewhere. So on that note, I think there's no better time than to start with Global Accessibility Awareness Day. This was the sub or the my signature line. Sorry, from an email I had sent on May 9th, 2012. I was working at a large corporation, and I wanted to let them know that Global Accessibility Awareness Day was happening. At the time, I was just a front-end developer. I did not have any sort of formal identification as an accessibility person within the company. Nobody knew I was there. Nobody knew that I knew about accessibility. So I just sent a little email. It was probably a little more calculated than I'll care to admit, but I sent out an email saying, hey, this is what's happening today. If you have any questions or you'd like to know more about what's going on, drop by my desk. And I signed it, your friendly neighborhood accessibility guy. I sent that out. And you know, the upside of this was, you know, I had now positioned myself as sort of a go-to resource within the organization, which was great. People were sort of bringing me into more projects and involving me more with sort of the planning. The downside, of course, was that I still didn't have all the answers. You know, I was still not an accessibility professional by any means. The one advantage I had there was that I knew where to look. So I reached out. I had been to camps, well, not very many camps. I had been to the accessibility camp in Toronto. I was following probably a lot of you on Twitter, and I knew sort of who to ask and how to ask and where to find the answers I was looking for. And in time, I was able, for the answers that I wasn't able to come up with right away, I was able to find these answers online and report back to my teams and get certain problems worked out. And it's great. But I did an entire talk last year about my story. I gave a presentation many, many times called How Accessibility Made Me a Better Developer. And it's still true, but it's online, so I don't really want to tell that story again. So I had a more fun idea this year. I was like, I've told my story, but you know, accessibility isn't one size fits all. So my experiences in accessibility shouldn't be that way either. So I reached out to as many different voices as I could think of, and I'm lucky enough to work with several of them. And I just asked them all the same question. What's the one thing you know now about accessibility that you wish you knew when you started? And the answer started coming back to me. One, two, three, four. Before I knew it, I had about 20 odd amazing answers. And this talk is actually the result of all of those answers. So I get off kind of scot-free by if you don't agree with something I'm saying, then you can blame whoever was in front of that quote. Okay, not really. So as the answers started coming back to me, I noticed they fell into sort of three very, very distinct categories. They sort of fell into those who sell it. So anybody on the front line, your BAs, your sales team, and you know, in many cases, even the client. So anybody that's sort of engaged in the agreement on making a site accessible. Then, you know, a lot of the answers were around those who build it. So of course, the developers, the UX team, the designers. And then those who support it. So the community at large, everyone out there that plays any kind of a role in accessibility. And of course, that's us, given that we've given up a huge chunk of our day, even if it's just a lunch hour or an hour here and there, but it's great. You know, we have an amazing community. So a lot of the answers that came back fell into these three categories. So it was pretty easy for me to organize a talk based on that. So one of the first few answers I got back was from John Foley. And he replied, "I knew early on that this was going to be an uphill battle, but those are the types of battles I relish taking on." And you know, that's kind of an amazing thing, because we've all been in that situation where we have to fight that battle when nobody else in that room is really buying into accessibility, and it's something that we feel we need to take on. So from that, I took away, be the loudest voice in the room. It's okay. It's okay to speak up. It's okay to bring it to the attention. Even if you're on sort of a kickoff, but not a kickoff call, but in a sort of an early planning call, just ask the question, you know, are there any accessibility concerns? Because 9 times out of 10, they hadn't even thought of it. And that opens up the door to a whole other conversation. The other side of that coin, though, is as much as you want to be the loudest voice in the room, you want to mention it whenever you can, don't be a jerk about it. You don't want to be the guy that brings it up ad nauseum, where people are just sick of you and they roll their eyes whenever they hear about you. So for those of you who cannot see your screen right now, I have Bart Simpson writing lines on a chalkboard, and it says, "I will stop mentioning accessibility in every meeting." So I asked Jennison, and he said, came back and said, "The problem isn't selling accessibility to a designer or developer. The issue is selling the value of accessibility to the client who is paying the bill and ultimately needs to make accessibility a stated requirement." And that's true. I mean, in order to sell that effectively to a client, in order to intelligently discuss the idea of accessibility with a client, what we really need to do is we need to educate the front line. We need to educate the people that are engaging that client to begin with. We have to talk to the sales team and the business analysts to make sure they understand that when you mention accessibility to a client, it's not a buzzword like gamification or synergy. This is something they really, really need to know about. And we need to educate them about the different kinds of disabilities. We can't just have them in there talking about screen readers or anything else. And we need to get it from the client as soon as we can. Open it up early in the conversation. When I asked my friend Critique, and he said, "The biggest lesson I've learned is that I should never treat one enterprise like another. Even though there may be some similarities, each organization stands on its own because of the people and culture. While applying lessons from working with one helps, it's never enough. Each stands on its own." And I thought this was really interesting. And the more I thought about it, it's true. When we're dealing with accessibility and talking about how to implement it in an organization, we don't know exactly how that organization is structured. For instance, we need, sorry, I got caught up writing. I thought there was a question there. We don't know how these organizations work. In one organization, it might be perfectly acceptable for somebody like a developer to make a design call on the fly. In other corporations, you need to go right back down to the UX and work it forward through planning again. So we can't just assume that, you know, we can tell a developer, well, do this, and he'll be able to do it that easily. It's never, ever that easy. So while we're at it, we need to educate the client. We have to be incredibly sensitive to their situation. We don't know what their stake in accessibility is. We don't know that, you know, we might not know if there is a complete corporate buy-in, or if it's something that's been if they're dealing with a lawsuit, or, you know, we don't even know what their knowledge of accessibility is. So a lot of them, they might be afraid of accessibility to begin with. So the way I've found in the past, the easiest way to sort of win their trust is to start with smaller projects. Maybe you're building a widget or refreshing a page or something. You know, show them that you can do this work and you can make something accessible on a smaller scale, and then it didn't have a huge effect on the time and budget of the project because you had sort of planned around it. And you know what, while we're at it, don't just educate the client, educate everybody. I used to host lunch and learns at my old company, and I just invite people in. We'd have sort of ask me anything type sessions. I would let people just, no question was too dumb. If they felt, I mean, we're hosting one tonight in Toronto, which is great. So our thing is just literally that. Ask us whatever you need to ask. If you don't feel comfortable asking the question, write it down on a sticky note or a piece of paper, leave it on my desk, and I'll address it in the next meeting. You know, some people, you know, they feel uncomfortable asking, you know, what is a screen reader or how do blind people use the internet? I mean, these are questions that we'll never answer if we're too afraid to ask. So I tried to make it really comfortable for anybody to ask me anything at any time. I asked William Lawrence, he said the one thing he learned after working in the field that he wished he knew from day one was how to understand different project managers. Which is true. Each project manager has their own style, has their own way of handling a project. And from this quote, I started thinking about how when I was a developer who cared about accessibility, I had a hard time getting the time to make things accessible because I didn't really have a PM who was there fighting for me. So after a while, I realized that I can't be everywhere. What I needed was a team of people that I could use. I needed to find a PM that cared enough about accessibility that would be there, that would have my back and fight for it with either the client or with their bosses to try, you know, the agency to try to get me the time I needed to do the work properly. I won over some of the folks on the UX team. I won over an art director and a few other developers. And before I knew it, I had this great team of people and they all cared about accessibility. So I made these ripples and before I knew it, they turned into waves. I had half the team on my side rooting for it and I got them to mention accessibility at every turn. So now I wasn't Bart Simpson sitting in front of a chalkboard again. I was, you know, just one of many people within this organization that were talking about accessibility as much as they needed to do. So I reached out to Jared from WebAIM and he came back and said, accessibility is a continuum. It is based on the user experience. It cannot simply be defined as pass-fail, accessible or inaccessible. And I think that sort of speaks for itself. I mean, there is no, I mean, some of the recommendations I probably made 5 years ago, my lack of experience aside, are probably not the way we would have. Yeah, it is you, Jared. Hi. We probably wouldn't make those same recommendations today just because the web has changed. And with that, our recommendations have grown and changed and evolved as well. So let's talk a little bit about those who build it. We're doing okay for time here. So I don't know if you guys feel comfortable. If you have any questions, you can either ask them at the end of each of these sections, you can shout them out wherever, or we can just save them to the end and you guys can just tell me how great I was then. However you want to work it is fine. So let's talk a little bit about those who actually build the internet. So I asked Mike what you know he wished he knew. And he came back and said, the direct link between usability, user experience, and accessibility. When I transitioned to usability, a light bulb came on and it helped me see the direct connection to understanding how users interact with high-tech interfaces before creating solutions. A second light bulb came on about 6 years ago, creating user stories and personas as a means for better communicating user needs to software developers. I like seeing people's faces light up when they see how lovely their quotes look on the screen here. So Mike's right, and he mentioned it in his talk last night. We need to talk about accessible user experience. And I think he quoted the buzzword, you know, the new saying, AUX is the new A11Y. And why am I talking about user experience now? I wanted to make a specific point of putting the UX part of this in with those who build it. Too many times we focus on the developer when we're talking about accessibility, and that's like saying building a house starts with that first swing of the hammer. There's a lot of planning that goes into a website before building. All of these are important steps in building a website. So plan on some level of accessibility. I said this in my talk last year. I always try to do it. There's always ways you can make a site accessible, even if it's not a stated requirement. You know, we can include people with disabilities in our personas. And I mean, I understand a client might not want to see this if it's not a stated requirement, but we can start small. We can start with an older user. They'll understand that. Chances are pretty good they are one themselves. And we can build the confidence in the client. And then after a while, again, it's all about winning that trust over and showing that we can do the job with minimal time and impact. Or sorry, impact on time and or budget. So then I reached out to Elle Waters. And she said, you know, you should always look for the source of the issue instead of spending a lot of time trying to fix stuff downstream. And that's true. I mean, if you're seeing the same issues over and over and over again, then, you know, your QA process is going to be a lot like sifting through the same garbage all the time. On the screen right now, I have a man canoeing through what looks to be a garbage dump. It's just a lot of pollution after a flood. That's a lot what your QA process will look like unless you take the time to properly train your team and address issues that you see over and over and over again. If you see that your organization and your developers or your UX folks are making the same errors over and over again, then maybe it's time to bring in some training. Maybe it's time to send them to some camps so they can pick up some information, or just send around a list of resources. There's really no point in spinning your wheels and correcting the same mistakes over and over again if you're not going to go back to the root of the problem and address it there. And I think more than anything, what we need to stop doing is dumping it all on the developer. On the screen, I have the boss from Office Space saying, yeah, we're going to have to ask you to make that accessible. And, you know, I usually ask for a show of hands here, and we have the little icons, but that's going a little bit too far. I'm sure we do have enough developers kicking around today that have been in that situation where it's not their problem. It shouldn't always, you know, you're asking them to build a complex UI, and if you haven't planned it properly, they're just guessing. And yeah, you're right, Paul. We could just slap world equals success on it, but yeah. So I asked Mr. Lembre, and he said, you know what, oftentimes there is no perfect development solution for accessibility. It requires balancing options and compromising. And you know what, that's true. There's probably many, many situations throughout the process where, you know, and even when you're dealing with legacy code, do you need to rip something apart? You know, sometimes we can slap ARIA on there and correct it, correct the issue that way, but is it always the best way to do it? But if we take the time to go back in there and fix code that probably should be, you know, more semantic, does that impact the budget and does that keep us from finding or fixing six or seven other issues? So there's always a bunch of negotiations that has to go on, a bunch of hard decisions. And unfortunately, these are decisions we're faced with making on a constant basis. Another big one, accessibility should never be a checklist. This is the first time I've gotten this quote right in the last three times I've given this talk. I made a fool of myself in Boston and went up there and stood in front of a room full of people and said, accessibility is a checklist, it is never a goal. And yeah, you can all imagine how the room took that one. So accessibility is not a checklist, and it is a goal. All right, we said this today, let's start with the basics, let's code to standards, and you know, a little semantic code goes a long way. If your developers don't know this stuff, then maybe the problem is your development team. That's just a hard truth. I mean, there's a lot of development teams that are great at building certain code, but you know, if they're not following standards and they don't get modern HTML and HTML5, then maybe it's time to either send them for more training or, you know, suggest that they upgrade their skill set and learn a little bit more. I'm not sure how trustworthy this next source is, but we'll read it anyways. Carl Grove says, looking back on what I know now, it took too long to be aware of interaction flow and focus management. There's a load of focus on the big three things, alt attributes, tables, and form fields, but bad interaction flow and focus management is a usability problem for a much greater number of people overall. And you know what? I couldn't agree with this statement more. I think we do. We spin our wheels a lot on you know, things like bad form fields and everything else. But I mean, at the end of the day, a form field is just a form field, but a modal that's not handled properly can screw up the entire page. And this is what we need to worry about. I mean, we rarely think about what is the purpose of this page and how is everybody going to get to every element on there? How are we going to control the experience so that, or not control the experience, but guide the experience so that the user can access all of the information and all the steps they need to in order to complete whatever task we have for that page. And you really don't want to make that Viking angry either. So that's another one. So on the screen, I have a very angry looking man with a keyboard that says, can see element on page, can't reach it with keyboard. All right. Now, I think this hammers home the point that we aren't just talking about the blind user here. There are plenty of users that just can't use a mouse. And if they can see something on the page that's not there, then that's, you know, that doubles the frustration level, because now they know something's there, but for some reason you have decided for them that it's not important enough for them to get to. So let's look beyond just the page semantics. Like we said, we have to pay attention to keyboard interaction. We have to pay attention to focus management. Like my good friend Scarface says, focus, folk you. Let's get over that one quickly. I asked Dwayne The Rock Johnson, a well-known accessibility professional, what he thought. And he said, know your role, state, name, and value. I didn't really ask The Rock, I'm sorry. I wish I knew. And it's true. We have Aria now that can help us fill in the gaps. I talked a little bit about this last week at Access U, and I said that I like to think of Aria as powerful, like nanobots or a super soldier serum that we can inject into our code that can make it that much stronger. I don't want to use it as a band-aid when we need surgery. I don't want to use it as I wish I had said it, but I got to give credit to Jared. I don't want to use it as accessibility lipstick on a usability pig. But it isn't, you know, when it first came out, it was supposed to just be this sort of bridging technology between XHTML or, you know, HTML 4.0 or 4.0 and HTML 5, but we've surpassed that. It's become way more important, and it can just do some stuff that HTML just can't do yet. So again, start small, you know, maybe start with landmarks, understand those, maybe start with some roles, understand that when you change the role on something that you are writing a check now that, or Aria is rather writing a check that you have to cash. You are the one now that is on the hook that when you call something a button, it better damn well behave like one. And you know, with that, you have to familiarize yourself with the design patterns. With certain widgets, certain key combinations are supposed to happen. And when they don't, you can alienate some users and confuse them. So following up on the Aria, Paul Adam said, you know, he wished he knew the HTML5 validator can check your Bay Area code for incorrect attributes and structure. Now, I believe you're talking about the new validator, Paul, which, it's true, it's great. But I mean, above and beyond just your Aria, always test your work. If you are a developer and you are making templates, it's probably the easiest thing to do. There are countless tools out there you can use to at least check the HTML, the semantics. Like Paul said, you can check the Aria. One test I like to do when I used to review code at my old work would be I would just open up whatever template was handed to me. I wouldn't look at it at first, and I would just hit tab a bunch of times. And if I could not find immediately where I was on the page, I'd stop reviewing it and I'd send it back to the developer. Because if you can't see where you are at any given point on a page, then you're not handling visual focus properly. And if you're not handling something as simple as visual focus, then I'm just going to assume there are other errors that you need to address. So I asked Mr. Faulkner what he wish he knew when he started that he knows now. He came back with an answer that I think Carl and I stayed up for a good half an hour one night just, you know, tossing this idea back and forth, and it was really, I mean, it blew my mind. It said browser accessibility implementation support for HTML features is as important as assistive tech implementation support. And that's true. We don't really talk about the API as much as we need to. I mean, we can have all the support we want. We can, our code can be as curt and great as we need it to be. But if there isn't a direct communication and the DOM, the API, and the assistive technology aren't getting along well, then it all falls apart. We need the browser to support the HTML features we're building in. So I asked Leonie, and she sort of expanded on that point, actually. She said if there was one thing she wished she had known about accessibility from the outset, it would be that there is a symbiosis between browsers and ATs. Understanding the relationship between the DOM, the Browser Accessibility API, and the AT is critical to understanding the UX for AT users. It's a complex relationship, but it's at the heart of so much of what goes wrong on the interwebs for people with disabilities. So it's true, like we said, the API sort of forms that handshake between your browser and your AT. And if they're not getting along well, then we all see the Three Stooges and we know what can happen there. On the screen, I have the Three Stooges not getting along well. But I asked Denis Boudreau, and he said, getting to using screen readers today. Seriously, I know it looks daunting, but it's really not as bad as it seems. Experiencing firsthand how screen readers behave and will expand your skills and understand. Oh, that should be understanding. I probably typed this in Denis' French Canadian accent, so it will expand your skills and understand of accessibility exponentially. But don't limit yourself to screen readers. Try other tools too. Okay, so that's true. I mean, we do have a number of free tools that are available and they're out there. TPG has some great tools. Hopefully a lot of you caught Steve's, did I lose my screen? Or somebody just moved stuff around? Did you guys lose me? Somebody is moving stuff around. All right, hold on a second. I'll just reshare this. We good? Okay, cool. All right, so we do have a lot of free tools that are out there. Hopefully you guys were around earlier to see Steve's presentation. If not, we'll figure out where and when we're gonna share these talks afterwards. But the tools are there. And like Denis said, if you can get into using AT, the sooner the better, that's great. There are a number of low-cost screen readers out there. We've got, if you're on a Mac, obviously you've got VoiceOver built in. It's just Command F5 when you start it up, people listen. If you are on PC and you can't afford JAWS, then there's always the JAWS demo to get you familiar with how they work. Beyond that, there's NVDA, of course, which is a free screen reader you can install and listen to. Those are the ones I would recommend starting with the most. So then I talked a little bit with Sarah Horton. Sorry. And she said she wished she had taken the time to learn and use assistive technology. There are great tools available that make interaction easier for everyone. when I see people using Siri for dictation and I'm still pecking away at the keyboard with one finger, or when I had shoulder surgery and instead of using dictation, I tried typing everything with one hand and all my correspondence was in lowercase. AT should be integrated and mainstream so everyone uses it. This quote was perfect on its own. And then the other night, Sarah, David, Sloan, and I were in Boston and we were driving around and we were lost because the streets of Boston are similar to, I guess, you know, if you were to zoom out on a map of Boston and then zoom out on a bowl of spaghetti, they would look pretty similar, the way the roads were set up. So we were lost and Sarah was trying to navigate. So she pulled up Google Maps and she started dictating to the maps and we were able to find our way again. So this is, you know, an example of somebody using dictation that doesn't necessarily need it. We could have pulled over, but it was amazing because it was integrated and it was something we could all use. 30 minutes late for my online presentation. So that's one example of another great example that I love to see is when you go to a shopping mall and you see how many people choose an escalator over stairs or an elevator. These are things that existed for a specific use, but now everybody's using them. So to recap a little bit, we talked about the clients, we talked about the people selling the clients, we talked about the planning and the development phases of a website, and introducing all of these people to accessibility. I've dealt with every single one of those people at various stages of my career, and there's one common feeling that runs throughout all of them. Whenever you mention accessibility to somebody for the first time, you get this. On the screen, we have the Wheel of Fortune puzzle, and it's F-dash-dash-dash accessibility. I'm not going to let anyone guess what that's supposed to be. It's fear accessibility. If you're thinking of anything else, then shame on you. I think the way we've gone about marketing accessibility is all wrong. I think instead of trying to scare people into doing the right thing, we don't focus enough on the good stories. I think we should take more time to reward companies that have done the right thing. So often a company will put so much time and energy into making something accessible, and, you know, we're well within our rights to just expect things like that to work. But when we have a really awesome experience on a website and we just move on, then as far as they know, they've just done this great thing and they've just cooked this great meal for us, and nobody has complimented the chef. So I think it's important that we put it out there once in a while for companies to, and let them know, you know, you've done this really, really well. Thank you. I'm guilty of it myself. I mean, we have this mentality where we're this angry mob, and that shouldn't be us. So I think the one thing we could probably focus on doing a little bit less online is shaming companies. I don't think we need to be these accessibility thugs or gangsters that just attack websites whenever they get something wrong, because all we're really doing is keeping that sort of negative opinion of accessibility alive and well. We're creating what I like to call a chain of demand, wherein, say, you're the client who gets this angry call from a user threatening legal action. Maybe it's the first they've ever even heard of this problem. Now suddenly the first thing they hear is you're going to get sued if you don't. There was never any sort of polite. I'm using extremes here, okay? I'm not saying we shouldn't do this in certain situations. But now the client is all riled up. So what does he do? Of course, he calls the person that built the site for them. Now they're freaking out. They're up in arms, and they don't know how to address this. This is all new for them. So what do? They pull the staff into an all-hands meeting, and now they're screaming, saying, this guy is mad. We're going to lose this client. We're going to lose money. People are going to lose their jobs. Heads will roll. So now the staff is super worked up, and guess who this gets pushed back down to? The developer. So now the developers are all worked up, and it ultimately, it's their fault that something's not accessible. This is all something we could have taken into consideration right from the beginning, because I mean, it's pretty common knowledge. If we build it, people will come, and they will complain about every single thing we got wrong. And then you know what they will do? Is they're going to put it on the world's biggest bug tracker. You may want to guess what that is. I think you're all thinking it anyways. It's Twitter. Again, we love to put things out there with the hashtag fail, and we love to complain about companies that got it wrong. But at the end of the day, are these companies even ever seen? Is anyone other than, say, like the intern or the social media manager even seeing these complaints and taking them to heart and addressing them? A lot of these companies that we're finding fault with, they have proper processes in place. And yes, I'm Canadian, so I'm going to use words like process instead of process. They have them in place to fix these bugs. So we should be taking advantage of that and working with them instead of against them right from the day one. People keep messing with stuff. Back. I've lost the chat, so I'm just going to assume that we are back. Okay, so now let's talk about us, those who support it. If you're new, then welcome. You're going to have a great time here. We are a good group of people, and you know we are set out to do great things. I asked my friend Patrick Dumpy, who is a colleague of mine in Toronto, and we work together on the Inclusive Design Meetup Group, as well as the Accessibility Camp Toronto. And he said, the accessibility community is by design an inclusive group and receptive to all questions and inquiries. Its intention is to level the playing field, ensuring that everyone has equal access to the same information. It's the best resource you didn't know you already had. Well, that's true. I mean, like I said earlier, I didn't have all the answers when I first identified myself as a resource people could use within my organization, but I knew where to look, and Twitter was often one of the first places that I could find information. I mean, the A11Y hashtag, we've all used it, and we've probably all yielded some pretty awesome results from it. So, you know, it is this powerful resource that's out there, and it's not just limited to Twitter. Of course, we've got WebAIM, we've got WebEx. There's tons of blogs and posts, and there are a lot of people that are active in the community that are willing to help us with this. So I asked Char. She said one thing she wished she knew was how many people were already involved who she could learn from. It probably sounds a bit silly now, but we didn't have Facebook or Twitter when I first got involved. Back in the old days, we relied on email lists and conferences, and no one from accessibility was going to the conferences that she was attending. So it's true. We do have it, like I just said, we have it pretty easy these days. We have all these resources that are available to us if we just take the time to seek them out. You know, we've got companies like the Paciello Group who are staying up and organizing these great events for Global Accessibility Awareness Day. We have events similar to this all over the world for Global Accessibility Awareness Day. So, I mean, look at the people that are participating today. Chances are pretty good that those same people wouldn't mind answering a tweet or an email to you. So I asked John Croston, who really started the whole Accessibility Camp business with Accessibility Camp PC. His reply was that starting a monthly accessibility meetup, Accessibility DC, and a yearly event, Accessibility Camp DC, was the easy part. The hard part was keep it going after 5 years. I wasn't entirely sure what he meant by this, and then we had sort of this longer conversation about it last weekend, and it was pretty amazing what we talked about. What he meant was that it's really easy to get people to come out to camps and meetups once. What do we do to keep these people engaged and interested in accessibility and working hard at it after the fact. And I think that's an issue we need as a community to address. And I mean, you know, it's just the nature of the beast. Some people will come in and, you know, really jump in and love it. People like Marcy, who are developers who really care, and Alice as well. They'll jump in and they'll stick around. Other people, they might not, you know, they might come to a camp or two and learn a few things. And it doesn't mean they've given up on accessibility. It just might mean that that's all they need to know. So some of it is about trying to keep people engaged and keep them active in our community and grow it. And other times it's a catch and release where we just have to, you know, hope that we did them well and that they've got enough and they've moved on and they're still preaching it. They just might not be as active because they might be involved in many other meetup groups, and it's just impossible to keep that many meetup groups going. I also like to look at this hand. I mean, at some point, hopefully, all of us as accessibility professionals will be out of work. I would love to see the day where we don't need to have an accessibility awareness day, where we can just count on the fact that these developers are implementing code properly, or at the very least, they're catching the easy stuff so we can move on and fix bigger problems and address UX and some bigger, you know, we've got bigger fist to fry than hunting down labels and alt attributes and bad tables in 2014. So the last guy I approached was section 508, because he's always got some great things to say on Twitter. His reply was, "I'd love to participate. However, I can't think of any one thing to contribute. I mean, I already knew everything when I got into accessibility." That kind of made me laugh, because it's true. I mean, we may not have all the answers as professionals. We don't. But when push comes to shove, what we do have is a very, very particular set of skills. Skills we have acquired over very long careers, and skills that make us a nightmare for people like them. And that's it for me. I've lost my chat here, so I don't know if there are any questions.